So, all right, everybody. I hope you are all well. Let's do a quick recap. You recall last time we were actually studying some properties, statistical properties of PDFs, right? Or distributions or densities. You know, I was showing, for instance, some multimodal PDF, meaning if this is a PDF, what were, for instance, modes of a distribution? The maxima, right? For instance, this is a mode. This is a mode of a distribution. Mean of modes are like mode is, mode, let's say. One of them, for instance, is there can be multiple maxima. It is arg max x, px of x, right? And if I had a PDF instead like this, for instance, like a Gaussian-like PDF, this is called unimodal. This is unimodal because it has a single mode, right? Mode, single mode. This is a, in a way, multimodal, multiple modes, multimodal PDF. We use this multimodal for other things too, for different types of data actually later. You'll see in life, you'll use it for that too. But so it's really like mode one, mode two. Then we know, of course, expected value of this PDF is the mean, right? Which is defined by the mathematical definition here, given the first moment, actually. We looked at moments of the distributions, right? Moments of, let's say, density, probability densities, equivalently distributions, right? And this was first moment. It may be, I'm just making it up here, of course, for instance, somewhere here. This is first moment. One moment. And the second, what is the second moment relating to? It's the variance. Yes, exactly. And for instance, here in this case, if it's a symmetric distribution for this unimodal one, mode is equal to, for instance, mean is equal to another variable we talked about, or statistic, is the median. So for instance, median is where health, maybe here, I'll just make it up, but maybe it's here. Right, I need to just count or integrate the PDF, find one health, or find the point where the PDF area is divided into two, right? This is the median. I have one health area and other half of the area here, right? So underneath here, px of px is one over two, right? This is, do you recall this? Median in this case is equal to mean and mode. This is the symmetric distribution. Remember, okay, we said variance, that ties to variance is proportional to the second moment because it is expected x square minus expected x, the square of the expected x. This is, we know it. So this is the second moment, of course. And this is actually the centralized second moment. We know these things. What was a symmetry, or what? Which of the moments was related to measuring symmetry of a PDF? Third moment, yeah. For instance, kurtosis, exactly. Third moment measures symmetry. It tells us whether, let's say, kurtosis PDF is symmetric or not. And there was a fourth moment measuring the tails, actually, or comparing the tails, actually, to the Gaussian tails. Tails, like heavier or lighter, heavy or lighter tails with respect to the Gaussian in the middle. Remember, this was fourth moment. Kurtosis was third. What was name of the? Ah, skewness. You're right. This was kurtosis. Sorry, guys. Of course. Of course. Because this is skewness, because symmetry of course relates to a distribution being skewed or not. I can have here, for instance, for skewness, we can have things like, for instance, okay, maybe let's do it here, or I can have, it's the other way around, right? I can have a heavy tail here, right? Or skewness, actually. It's not heavy, actually, skewness here. Skewness, right, skewed, for instance. We measure it by the third moment, or left skewed. I think we've seen these in this, okay, recap for now, that's fine. We've seen, okay, last thing from last time is covariance, right? This was measuring how multiple random variables vary or covary with respect to each other, right? It was measuring their correlatedness. Remember, and what was the formula or definition? It tries to look at, for instance, for two random variables, it tries to look at, for instance, something like this, when the means are zero, or actually more generally, let's just center these guys, right? That is, subtract their mean values or expected values. This is the covariance. I mean, this is when mu x is zero, mu y is zero. The intuition is, remember, when they both, for instance, increase together, then the first one is positive. There is positive correlation. When one is decreasing, the other is increasing. Remember, I mean, if I have a data distribution which looks which like x and y, I mean, are distributed in this way, maybe more or less, we see actually a positive correlation or some linear dependence. It's not independence or dependent, but some, there is some linear association between the two. Remember, covariance, or equivalently, the normalized version was the correlation coefficient. Remember, where we normalized covariance by the standard deviation of the two RVs, exactly, correlation coefficient, equivalently, right? And when, of course, we may have other types of covariance where this is covariance positive, or rho is positive, let's say, rho positive case here, rho, for instance, negative case would be when x and y are actually inversely covarying, like meaning, now, when one of them increases, the other gets negative, right? So E dot, so this guy in a way gets negative, right? More negative. This was it. And we know the relation to independent. When two RVs are, or multiple RVs are independent, their correlation would be zero. Final thing I want us to remember is multivariate Gaussian, right? Okay, you guys remember also, let me write this. Independence implies uncorrelatedness. Okay, rho is zero, RVs are, remember, we say RVs are uncorrelated. This is important. This was rho less than zero case, rho greater than zero case. This is the third case, right? One, two, and three. And independence, when x and y or multiple RVs, they are independent, this automatically implies they are uncorrelated. But remember, this way is not implied generally. So this would mean RVs could be uncorrelated, but it doesn't mean they are independent. They could be dependent still, okay? We've seen an example for that. But there was an exception. I'll write this now. Remember, we looked at, I think, covariance. Okay, yeah, for multivariate Gaussian. So maybe let's write this. We wrote this for bivariate, but I'll write it now for a little bit more general. Multivariate Gaussian PDF. So this means, actually, I'm writing the joint PDF for for instance, n are v's, x1, x2, 2, xn. So imagine you have these n random variables and I'm writing them there. And I know they are actually jointly Gaussian. What is their the form of their PDF? I will. We can always define a vector, guys, like this. This is a random vector. Okay, x. So now I can write actually, and I can say, hey, then I can have a vector form expected value. So this is another vector. Underscore is typically a underbar is typically a vector notation. So this would be, for instance, mu1 is the expected value of the random variable x1. Mu2 is the expected value of random variable x2, and so on. Okay, transpose, it's a column vector. So now I can write the joint PDF. So let's say joint PDF for this random vector x, p sub x, x. So everything is in vector matrix form here. Here, important thing, okay, there will be some terms for with the covariance matrix. We've written this last time with two RVs. X minus, these are vectors. There is a quadratic form here, guys. This is a covariance matrix. Its inverse is here. And it's the typical or usual Gaussian exponential, right? Remember, for a scalar, this is really x minus mu squared over sigma squared. But here it is the covariance matrix. What is the covariance matrix? We've seen it last time. It contains variances of each RV in the diagonal. Okay, so all the way to xn. And in the off diagonals, what does it have? Covariances, exactly, covariance of pairwise. So it's like here at the end of this row, okay, the end of this row, I have covariance x1, xn, and then it's symmetric matrix here, I would have covariance xn, x1, but it's the same thing, right? So this would be covariance x2, x1, but these are equal, of course. These are equal, so symmetric. This is a covariance matrix, is an important matrix. Please know this very well. It's a symmetric, and we assume it is always positive definite. Why? We, you know, positive definite matrices, right? They are invertible. Their determinants, then, because if it's positive definite matrix, their determinant is positive, which is great because I need to invert this guy. It has to be invertible. So then it is invertible. And I was telling you last time, we like to work with the C because then, for instance, we can talk about or discover important dimensions in the data set. We can do for some singular value decomposition or eigenvalue decomposition, right? So this would be the matrix of eigenvalues. Do you recall this? So let's see. Okay, maybe not. Let's just talk about eigenvalues at this point. I assume everybody took numerical methods. No, you didn't. But you took linear algebra at least. Okay, it's good. Eigenvalue decomposition is covered in linear algebra, right? Perfect. Singular value decomposition? No. Okay. Okay. It's fine. Eigenvalue decomposition is fine. It's for the symmetric positive definite matrices, very nicely defined. This is a matrix of eigenvectors, remember, right? These guys are actually, it becomes the same two eigenvector matrix in this case. So these are really like V1 to Vn. I'll take just a single underbar. Guys, double underbar is a matrix. Single underbar is a vector. Okay. Is this completely new or do you recall this from last time? We did this for 2D. Now it's n-dimensional. Any questions? General, we're talking about general, multidimensional, random variables actually. We form them, put them into a vector form, and then we talk about covariances. Because it's multiple RVs, we look at covariances between, right, among all those RVs actually. Now, here, guys, for the multivariate Gaussian, remember there was a special case. If our covariance matrix is diagonal, what does this mean? If it's a diagonal matrix, look at this matrix. Covariances are zero, right? So all the RVs are uncorrelated. Okay, so then the RVs in our X, X, I could actually maybe say X vector, X1 maybe transpose. No, it's, these are now just single X1, X2 to Xn, right? These RVs are uncorrelated, let's say. And we can show that these are Gaussian, by the way, right? It's a multivariate Gaussian. We can show that this implies they are independent. Guys, how can we do this? Just insert. So C becomes really just sigma 1 squared, all zeros, right? Sigma 2 squared, sigma n squared, all zero in off diagonals. Insert this into the PDF, joint PDF. We can maybe, I can do a few lines and you can show this, okay? Show this. I'll do a little bit. And I need for a diagonal matrix, okay, look at the form of PX here. Ah, I didn't complete here, sorry guys, this part, the scalar part here. I have to multiply square root 2 n times, right? That's why I have this 2 pi to the power n over 2, correct? Because I have n vectors there, or n RVs, and I need determinants of C to the power 1 over 2 too. Here, I need C inverse, covariance inverse in the exponent, so I need to look at its inverse, but it's a diagonal matrix, so it would be really, I mean, this is a notation. Sigma 1 inverse, of course, 1 over sigma 1. Let me write it the other way. It would be not to the power minus 1, but 1 over sigma 1 squared, 1 over sigma 2 squared. Do you know this symbol? Diag means it's a diagonal matrix. Again, another diagonal matrix, right? Inverse of a diagonal matrix is diagonal, right? So 1 over sigma 2 squared, 1 over sigma n squared, all everywhere else is zeros, right? This will be the inverse covariance matrix, right? This is inverse covariance matrix in the diagonal case, which is great. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to invert it easily like this, right? Okay, so now, guys, I'm writing, inserting it into this form. I'll skip a few lines because you can show this. This is really some algebra. Now this is really because I have multiplication of all the sigma I squared, right? Determinant. I should ask you, what is the determinant of C in this case? For okay, let me ask you this. What is the determinant? Exactly. So yes, that would be really this guy, right? I'm carrying it to the here, to this page here. That's why actually it's now product square root 2 pi sigma I squared, right? In the denominator. Perfect. So now exponential in the exponent, if I really insert this diagonal matrix into this px of x, the joint density, and those are all vectors, please work it out, because C inverse is an easy, very simple diagonal matrix with 1 over sigma squared. It becomes really multiplication of each separately. Let me write it. But it's in the exponent, so it becomes here. At this point, it's a sum. I'll make it a product later. Xi minus mu I squared, sigma I squared. Actually, this is really equal to, guys, I1 to n I can rewrite this as pi sigma I squared exponential minus 1 over 2 sigma I squared. And this is really equal to, so px of x is really equal to sum I px of xi, right? I want to n. So this is really showing each of these xi's are scalar univariate Gaussians, guys. Mu I sigma I squared. So what did we show? We started by assuming that RVs are uncorrelated. We ended with this result where we factor the joint PDF into multiplication of the marginal PDF. So it's independence, right? When you see such a thing, you directly arrive at the conclusion that these RVs are independent. So therefore, guys, for Gaussian, multivariate Gaussian, for multivariate Gaussian, uncorrelated RVs implies independence. Okay, uncorrelated RVs is equivalent to the covariance matrix being diagonals, right? I mean, off diagonals are covariances, they are zero. So that is also equivalent to covariance of all xi, xj are zero for I is not equal to j, right? Yeah, perfect. Okay. They are, so RVs are also, let's say RVs are also independent. So implies, uncorrelated RVs implies independent RVs, x1 to xn. Okay, so we came from, you see, this is a univariate or just scalar one-dimensional, right? For all I1 to n, these guys, xi's are normal or Gaussian. And we started with this joint multivariate normal, and we can show it by normal with a vector, mean vector, and covariance matrix, okay? Multidimensional covariance. I think that should be fine. Last time we also talked about, remember, correlation versus causation. And as someone who is taking this course, you guys know correlation does not imply causation, right? There is no relation. We talked about, always remember that chocolate consumption and Nobel Prize. Number of Nobel Prizes for a country, of course, it has nothing to do with chocolate consumption. They just co-vary together due to other factors, of course, other underlying factors of wealth of the countries and things like that, right? Okay, so now today, let's continue with conditional expectations. We will study conditional expectations first part, and then we'll study limit theorems, and those will be actually completing all the related probability part of this course today. Last 3 weeks we will be doing estimation, okay, statistical estimation. It will be more statistics, so we are completing the probability material today, which is a lot of, we've covered a lot of material already. Okay, so guys, given value y, so I'm after this, actually we've probably seen this a little bit before, right? So give of an RV, so again I have two RVs, x and y, but I'm giving one of the values, right? For one of them we know the definition of this guy, right? I need to use the conditional, right, corresponding y here. I mean, probability of x given y, of course, little x given y, x. And I need to, I also wrote the discrete version here, but I need to integrate this x times Or I can sum it up. I was trying to say this. I can either integrate or sum it up for discrete RVs. This is the definition of conditional expectation. Do you guys recall there was a stick breaking example? Recall that example. There was a stick. You call stick breaking example, guys. There was this stick of length L. We were breaking, I think, at first at a uniformly actually picking a number Y, okay, a location Y, and breaking it at that point, remember? And then from that piece we were breaking it again. That was X variable breaking. We were breaking it break at randomly at, let's say, or uniformly, uniform RV, of course, uniformly at Y, and then we were breaking uniformly at X, right? So, okay, out of here, it was again, this was the stick, broken at point X. Here we were, I think we looked at it probably at that time, but now if I first, guys, it was the first piece was obtained by breaking at a point Y. So I'm fixing that, right? So now I have a little Y, okay? We've calculated this before, but this was intuitively, it was actually intuitively given Y. The now, okay, here guys, it's this one. What is expected value of, now I know Y, I already broke it at Y. Now expected value of X given Y would be half of, yes, Y over 2. We've done it, I think, last time. It was very intuitive. Okay, so this was for a specific value of Y. Now the point here is the conditional expectation. We can actually, okay, we just talked about a given value of Y, okay, little y, but I can actually talk about all possible values of that Y. So I can actually move this from being actually, so this is, guys, for a known Y value to, that is also random actually, I don't really know that. So now this Y is a capital Y, sorry, it's an RV. So this guy, this expected X given Y for all values of Y, because I don't know that Y, that becomes a random variable too. Until here, I believe we were talking about X given Y equals a specific value. Guys, now that little Y is also unknown, we make it a random variable, we consider all possible values of that Y, are we? So now this guy is, you see, Y is a random variable. So maybe I should really say I have X, Y, two RVs, right? Two given RVs. We are working with those guys, actually. We should have written that down. So guys, now this is really like a function of Y, right? So that's why we consider it as an RV, right? That's a function of Y. Function of Y, that's the idea here. So we consider then really expected XY, X given Y, sorry, is considered as an RV. Why am I trying to do this? Because when it is an RV considered, I can take its expectation. Let's take its expectation. This is an RV. So it's really expectation of the conditional expectation. We can look, we will just derive this actually. It amounts to a very simple result. It's going to be expected X. It's really like taking expectation over all over possible values of Y, right? Of that conditional expectation. So this is relating to, or the general topic here is law of iterated expectations. Just let's write this while you're reading from textbooks. know this actually topic. Now this is, let's just derive this. I've already told you the result, but let's just do this here, guys. Expected value of the conditional expectation x given y. So now I want to do this for all y. Okay, let's maybe this time, all right, use sum. It could be integration. I just use whichever comes to mind here, right? Integration or sum, depending on the, of course, discreteness or continuousness of the corresponding RV. So this is really, let's say I will be considering all values of y right here. And this is really like my g of y, right? And then I need p y of y, right? So do this math here. It's really, in the end, really this is expected g of y, right? And we know that is really sum over all y, g of y, p y of y, okay? So this is also looking like, by the way, maybe I should say, recall, this is really for all possible y's. I'm using a divide and conquer approach. Do you recall the total expectation theorem? Expectation theorem. Remember, we were saying all possible scenarios. I divide my problem into all possible scenarios and calculating all those conditional expectations and weighting it by the corresponding probability. Okay, so this is really taking weighted average. This is the weight, right? Taking weighted average of all possible scenarios in a way, right? This is really like that, average of all possible scenarios, okay? Also, you can mathematically show here, we can maybe, let's do the math here, show that. Now I will be opening up this expectation, expand it here, right? I will this time sum over x's. Guys, I took the above line there, sum over y. Now expected x given y, that's a sum over x, right? Probability x given y. X given y again, and I bring also p y, right? I just rewrote the first line. Guys, do you agree from the top line to this line? Are we following? Okay, and what is this multiplication? Marginal PYY, PX given Y times PY. Exactly, joint PDF, perfect. PXY, X given Y. So now this is actually, let's maybe just do, okay, I had an X here, so I'll take X summation out and bring the Y summation here, because this will be, I'm just marginalizing over y, which is px, right? Marginal x. So you see, nice result. We have expected value of x. Guys, so bring this here. On the left-hand side, I had this iterated expectation. Expected value of the conditional expectation x given y is really expected x. We showed it, okay? This is, so it's really like, expected value of a conditional expectation equals to an unconditional expectation, which is really nice. So iterating on the expectation brought me to an unconditional expectation. Okay. So for instance, in this stick example, let's say here, for instance, e.g., in the stick example, let's do this, expected x given y. So this would be really expected x. And what is expected x here? It was divided twice. So the expectation, intuitively also you can find it. It was, I think we calculated it last time, L over 4, guys, so it's really L over 4, for instance, in the data example. So we should say in words also here, expectation of a conditional expectation ended up being an unconditional expectation. Okay. So I think mathematically very straightforward, right? I mean, are there any problems or questions? This was conditional expectations. Now we look at conditional variance. Right? It's getting more and more interesting. So now it's conditional variances. Hang in there. Probably this is really the last thing in this aspect. Okay. So we look at, again, in a conditional, we are in a conditional universe. We can look at expectations or first moment. We can also look at the variance, second moment. So this will be really variance X given Y. And this guy will become also an RV. As with the same arguments we did here, guys, here. You remember Y was an RV here. And then due to Y RV being RV, this guy is an RV. This is important. Similar arguments. I mean, I could have said Y is a certain little Y, X given Y, for this variance. But for all the Ys that I don't know, I mean, it's a random picking, right? I don't know this guy. So I also assume this is an RV, or I can really take it as, consider it as an RV, okay? So this is an RV as well, variance X given Y. This was for a specific value, of course, for a specific Y value. And consider all Ys here. That's why it becomes a variance. Variance X given Y becomes a random variable. Okay? So the definition is variance X given. Okay, let's do it with a specific value, and we can just remove that specific value after we actually evaluated for all Ys. So this would be really X minus expected X given, X given Y equals Y squared, right? I need this guy squared, and given Y equals Y is in the overall expectation. So this is really expected mean, conditional mean, right? Conditional expectation, let's say, of course. Conditional expectation. And this is really variance in a conditional universe. Are we okay with this definition also? We are adding actually a conditioning on our variables. Now from here, we will talk about something called law of total variance, where we will use conditional expectation and conditional variance. This is a nice expression actually. Guys, will we take variance of a random variable X, we'll divide it into two. We'll say, hey, I can decompose or write the variance of X, guys, this is interesting, as expectation of variance X given Y, okay, plus variance of, it's like expectation of the variances, and second term is variances of the expectations. This is, I should use for the expectation, the square, sorry, parentheses, that's what I was trying to do here. X given Y, okay. So this is like my total variance. And I'm after that total variance X, but then there is a related variable Y, okay. And that actually helps me decompose this variance into two parts. So we'll see now what this means. It has two components, so let's derive or write this. So this is first, this is the second term. So first term, okay, on the right hand side. So let's just write this guy. So guys, variance, remember, of course, variance x normally is, we know everybody in this class recalls this formula, right? Variance we can define as expected value of x squared, the second moment, minus the square of the expectation. Remember, this is basic from several weeks ago, we know. So now we can rewrite this in a conditional universe. Okay, I'll just write this as variance x given y, guys, where I'll just add the conditioning, okay? X squared given y minus expected x given y, the total thing squared, right? Do we agree? I just took the formula up there and rewrote it with a, this is, let's say, valid for a conditional universe, right? Universe. Now we'll take its expectation. Guys, expected value of this variance x given y. So this is double expectation. Guys, check this out. This is iterated expectation. So I'm taking expectation of that second line there, right? In this first term, x squared given y minus again an expectation of the squared of the conditional expectation here. So maybe, guys, I should say this was squared. This is it, right? What is this first term? You guys tell me. We just learned this. Exactly. Thanks. Great. You noticed. It makes life easy for us. That's an expected x squared. We just solve the formula. Of course, it can be applied to functions of it. Great. You guys noticed it. Thank you. Now, guys, this was the first term. We'll leave the second term as it is, because now we'll expand that second or two, number two. We'll see some manipulations there. This is, let's leave this first term here. Now look at the second component. It was variance of the expected value of x given y, right? Variance of the conditional expectation. So let's now continue with that derivation. That guy, okay, let me write it just to quick from here. This would be really, again, remember our variance x formula was the usual formula, x square, expected x square minus square of the expected x, right? Now we apply the same thing here to the conditional expectation. So this would be really expected x, I need to take its expectation, of course. Huh? Okay, yeah, I need to now take this expectation squared, right? Let me, I introduced another squared here. Okay, minus, now I need actually this term squared, right? I'm applying that top formula here, guys. Oh, okay, maybe this should go there. Then that is really expected x given y squared, right? Expected, but I need one more. Of course, I need to take its expectation. Expected x. So here I was trying to do this actually, guys, because it's really this one, iterated x. I mean, this was the, think of this as x, so I need one more expectation, right? This guy's squared. I mean, it's not x, of course. I'm just trying to really replicate what is up there. So wherever I see x in that usual formula, I need to insert the conditional expectation. This is good. So guys, the here, which term, there is a cancellation. This is a plus. Look at this term, this first term. It is expected value of that conditional expectation squared. It is here. They cancel each other. So this one was minus. This cancels with first term from 2. Let's say next page for your notes. Okay? They canceled. Now we sum them up, guys. And first, also, I should ask you, what is this guy? Inside, just inside, I should write probably. It is expected x, right? And it will be squared, of course, right? Because it's iterated expectation. Inside the square is expected x. So what we ended with was 1 plus 2 is really expected. So variance x is, of course, as we expected. Expected x square was left from the first term, right? One, number one. And from the second one, we had expected x squared remaining, right? And this is really equal to variance x. We just proved actually this formula, law of total variance, right? Which is from here really variance of x. The first one we will call actually the variances. Okay, let me first write it and we'll make the intuition expected. So this first term is expectation of variances of actually these conditional variances. And then second one is really variances in a way between the means. Okay, that will be the intuition. So let's maybe make an example. I have two examples, let's see, for this. After that, we can give a break. I think this is a nicer example. Let's first start this one with this one. Mm-hmm. Okay, guys, so this is total variance theorem again. We'll make use of this, okay? Total variance. Theorem, did we say theorem? Law of total variance law. Okay, let's make use of this in an example. Next page. So, example, there is a class, guys. 30, there are 30 students in this class. Okay, and there are two sections with two sections, and these guys take a quiz. Okay, they take a quiz. We will define two random variables of interest, x and y. There is an x which is the quiz score of these students, and y are the section numbers of the students. Okay, so we have two RVs of interest in this problem. We can actually just give some more information, guys. The section one has 10 students. Section two has 20, of course, then 20 students, section two. Now we are given some statistics, okay? Quiz statistics. We are given some quiz statistics. Quiz average in section one was 90. Quiz average in section two was 60. Now we will calculate these expected values. And the variances actually of in each section and also across both sections. Okay, so we start with expected value of the quiz score. Okay, so let's take a look. Expected x, I can go with, first of all, I go to both sections. And I can actually, what was given, quiz average one was 90 for the first section. How many students are there? So it was really 1 over 10 xi. This was 90, right? And for the second section, I have some this is, let's say, 1 to 10 first 10 students, and maybe let's say this is the remaining 20 students. So I have I 11 to 30, XI, it's again, I mean, it's of course just 20 students, these guys are 60. So of course expected X would be addition of these two, right? So it would be really 1/30, some I want to 30 students XI. I need to add these 900 and 1200 and divide them by. Okay, it's actually common coming from here. 90 times 10, 900. 60 times 20 over 30, right? And we are probably, intuitively, it's not difficult, but we're trying to do it like more rigorously. What is this? What was this result? I think it ends up being 70. Now we will, my goal is to look at conditional expectations. Actually, that is given, right? What is given was here. X given, Y equals 1. These are given, right? What are these expectations? For instance, what is expected X given Y equals 1? 90, exactly. Actually, I could have written here, this is this guy. This is exactly this guy. Now we will say, hey, remember, this is, I think, a good example. This is NRV, actually, out of these two, because I really don't know which section I'm picking, right, when I do this conditional expectation. That's why this is NRV. This is a random variable, is a random variable, and it is actually equal to 90 with some probability and 60 with some probability. What is the section one proportion? What word? 10 out of 30 students, so with probability 1/3, and this is with probability, sorry, maybe I should say. So this would be the definition of this random variable, right? I mean, it's, we've given its PMF. This is an RV and this is its PMF, right? And if I were to really plot it, it would be 60 and 90, right? Quiz scores. And this would be really 2/3 and 1/3. Its PMF is here. So guys, the expected, let's take the expected value of this PMF or this RV, expected value of this conditional expectation. I will just look at the PMF and say 60 times 2/3 plus 90 times 1/3. 90 times 1/3, right, plus 60 times 2/3. That is actually 70. So I solved it in a way in two ways. Maybe this is more layman material. Someone who hasn't taken probability course, like you, more advanced probability, they would go, right, sum all these and, you know, in proportion, add them up, divide by the total number of students. Or people like you, more advanced, elite class of people, you would go from that second conditional expectation way. You see, we arrived at the same conclusion, but you see, you guys know this is really equal to expected X, right? It's a iterated expectation. Not everybody, if you pull somebody from the street, maybe they can do that calculation in that box, but not everybody can go with the more mathematical, rigorous way. That's the point. This is really good. Now we'll go to the variance, guys. Variance of the conditional expectation. Now, this is what we are after. Expectation, I said, and I'm skipping it. Variance of the expected X given Y. We are after this one. So actually, I know the PMF of this RV, right? And I know its mean. I can calculate its variance. half, subtract 70 from 60, square it, weigh it by its own property plus, exactly, you guys get the point. That's the basic variance definition. So let's do that first in that way. 1 over 3 times, for instance, okay, I just did the 91. 1 over 3 times 90 minus 70 squared plus, you see now I go 60 minus 70, 2 over 3 times 60 minus 70 squared, right? This is the variance definition of this RV, variance of this RV on the right hand side. Good, you guys. Okay, it's really my square distance from the mean. This is the mean. I'm taking a square distance from there and weighing it by the probability, corresponding probability. So now I may want to go to the total variance. Okay, so for that I need, let's say I'm given, let's say we are given the variances in each section. We are given variances in each section. You see, we don't know the whole quiz scores, right? That's why we need all these calculations like expectations, variances. So variance of x given for the first section is given as 10. Variance of the second section is given as 20. Actually, these are also, I know they can be written as, that's equivalent to, I know this, right? 1 over 10. I want to 10. Now I have xi minus 90 because I know the first section's mean was 90. This is 10. And for here, I have exactly I is 11 to 30, exactly xi minus 60 squared. This is given as 20, right? Because we are given the expected values in each section as 90 and 60. Guys, that's why I am able to write this, right? So now, I mean, from here, remember, we also said variance x given y is an RV2 and its PMF I can write, right? Again, with probability, it's exactly like here. For instance, with probability 1 over 3, it's 10. With probability 2 over 3, it's 20. That's right. It's 10. With probability 1 over 3, it's 20. With probability 2 over 3, this is again a PMF, right? It's an RV with PMF. You guys see, this is the variance x-wise PMF, 10 with probability 1 over 3, and it's 20 with probability 2 over 3, right? These are all valid PMFs again. So what is its expected value? Guys, it is expected value of, I'm after, because it's an RV, random variable, I can take its expectation, and it's easy to just calculate from the PMF, right? So just do the math here, 1 over 3 times 10 plus 2 over 3 times 20. Okay, that just ended up 50 over 3. Okay, now the total variance, guys, we know from the law of total variance, I can add those two. I already calculated those two. Now we will be saying, actually, let's maybe write it again. There was this term, expected variance x given y, plus the one up there, right? Variance of the expected conditional expectations. So this is really 50 over 3 plus, did we calculate the other one up there? Here, this was, okay, guys, I didn't write it, but it was 200. So it's really this guy. So that would be the total variance, okay, of the quiz scores, right? Total variance of the quiz scores. We call this, typically, guys, this is called average variability within sections, for instance. It can be interpreted within sections. So average variability, you see, I'm finding in a way variance of each section separately, then taking its expectation or average. This is what it means. Now, the second one is variability between sections. This is important, variability between sections. So it's really variance we are looking at, variance of the expected value of each section in a way, or mean scores of each section, how separated they are. So this is really important two terms, guys. I think I have some motivational. Let's also do this. And so here is an interpretation again, guys. Say this time we had three RVs, okay? Say we have three RVs. I mean, three sections, for instance. Okay, let me say three sections. That's better. And it's really like, let's say scores are, okay, let's make it maybe a single axis here. Xi vertical is scores, right? And let's say scores are distributed like, okay, I have maybe some mu one here for the first section. Okay, first section. Maybe, I mean, they don't have to be this separated, but for visualization, I'll just make it up in this way. Okay, maybe second one is separated or distributed in this way, and they have their corresponding sigmas, right? Variances, plus minus sigma. Sigmas in both ways, not sigma, the standard deviation, of course. Mu two, again, maybe it's a little bit more separated. So maybe let's make this, or let's make the third one less separated. So maybe mu three is in this way. Mu three students were actually getting all close to the average, maybe. Okay, these were separated, larger sigma here. And this one maybe had a small sigma or standard deviation. Okay, maybe here, plus minus, right? So we said, guys, the first term is average of each section, or average in a way variance, sorry, average variability of each section, within section. So it's really like average of those three variances, right? The first term in the total variance law is really measuring average of sigma I square in a way, or variances. So average of variances within each section. This is the intuition, right? Within each section. So these are score distributions, by the way, right? Score PMFs, let's say. Okay, but scores are distributed in this way, as let's say PI, you know that they are PMFs. So let me write this. Is this clear for this first term? This was expected value of variance x given y. Y given y is the section information, right? For each section, I calculate its variance. I take an average actually out of them. So expectation of the variances, first term. Second term is spread of the means actually. Looks at what was it? Let's variance of expected x given y, right? Variance of the means. So it really looks at how those mu one, mu two, mu three are spread from or away from each other. I think this intuition is very important. So it's really looking at variability, guys, between or variability of mu one, mu two, mu three, or it's equivalently like how widely at, right, the mu i's are for each group or mu i's are for each section. Each section meaning, for instance, if I had something like this, mu 1, mu 2, I mean, this could be a little bit far away, then they would be really more spread, right? The variance would be higher, mu 1, if mu 2 moved here, right? That variance or variability between mu's would be, okay, let's maybe not write it here, but this is, look at the then distance between these two section means versus or maybe let's put it here. If they were more like this, maybe mu 1, mu 2, now they are much more separated, right? Which one has larger variability? This first one on the left, right? So that second term, the variance or variation between the means would be larger in this one. So that is I think nice intuition, important interpretation of this total variance, guys. Okay. I will give an exercise. I have one more example, by the way. I can, or we can give a break and then do that example and then go to the limit theorem. And I will give you guys an exercise for home. Before we go to the break exercise, you guys use again total variance law. I'm giving you a px of x with two parts. Okay, 1/3, 2/3. It's a PMF. Okay. PMF of X, but I also, this is a continuous RV, given a continuous RV X with this actually PDF. Actually, it's a PDF with PDF here, right? It's continuous, of course. Guys, I should really just show it in this way. And we are also given or we are using this divide and conquer approach. You guys will define this y equals 1 and y equals 2 portions of this. So define this RV of x. Define y, for instance, it's 1 for x is between 0 and 1. It's 2 for x is, between 1 and 2. Okay, so what are the probabilities of this y random variable? It's the area underneath, okay? So this is 1/3. So with probability 1/3, this area is 1/3 and this is 2/3. So this is really with probability 2/3. So y is really a function of x. I want you, is a function of x. I want you to continue with this, like expected x given y equals 1. This is an exercise, so I'm not really solving it fully. What are these? Then calculate variances. Okay, variance x given y equals, you can do this. So what are these? From here, you can also talk about what is expected x, right? And what is the variance of this conditional expectation? From there, please also look at the, use the total variance law. Okay, solve it in this way. Because if I asked you the variance x directly, other way, guys, note, variance x can be also directly calculated from the PDF, right? But you can do it, use it as a check if you want. I mean, you don't need to, however. Just write directly calculated from, let's just write the formula here, okay, also. The mathematical expression. Maybe you don't need to calculate that. There is some integration there. Not difficult, but still you need integral manipulations here. You see, this is versus. Can you do this? I gave you, actually, I outlined most of it. I mean, you have the XPMF, PDF, Y has a PMF, easy PMF. You guys can find these, actually, all these statements, right? Exercise, guys, please. That would be a good exercise for it. So I think let's do the last example after the break. Any questions at this point? Are we following law of iterated expectations and conditional variances, total variance theorem or law? Yeah, you have to go over it, of course, on your own. So let's give a break now. All right, let's continue with this example. Now we will look at some of a random number of independent RVs. Guys, here it's important. Random number of independent RVs. Let's say this example was from Bert Seka's lecture. It says, hey, you visit a number of stores and spend some money. Here, the random N is the number of stores visited, and you spend some money in each store, money spent in store I, and we will be interested in the sum of the money you spent. So it will be actually sum of XI. So XI are, guys, IID, we know, right? Independent, identically distributed. This is something you'll encounter all your life in this field, IID, independent, identically distributed RVs. Also, this N is a non-negative integer RV, and XI, this is another thing, XI, and N are independent. These RVs are independent. So N is, you see, is a random variable that indicates number of stores visited. Okay. N is, okay, let's write it again. N is a non-negative integer. Let's write it here separately, RV. And we are interested in the total amount of money you spent that day. Let's say you went to shopping that day, visited a number of stores, spent some money in each store, and we are interested in the sum of money you spent. Okay, this is what we are interested in. Now we first ask these two questions, or actually I think they are our ultimate goals. Expected, what is the expected value of that sum money you spend, and what is its variance? Okay, we are interested in these two. We'll go, as you guess, we'll go from the conditional expectations with iterated expectations, use the total variance law and the tools we've learned, right? So we will start with actually first fixing Y given. We have to fix the number of stores, right? Because and otherwise I don't know how many of these exercises to sum, right? So guys, I will say, hey, Y was actually really X1 to X here in this case, little n. Now I'm given that I visited exactly little n stores, right? This is a given. This is a conditional universe, given n equals n. But there is not one nice thing here. X, I told you, random variable xi and random variable capital N are independent. So this conditional expectation actually reduces to unconditional expectation, right? When two RVs are independent, I don't need to really here keep this conventional universe, right? They are independent, so really it's expected x1 to x little n. So I believe you guys, just for your notes actually, I'll write this. And we know from linearity of expectations, I can really write this as, are we on the same page until here? This derivation, okay, great. This is really n times expected x. So given n, I mean, expected x is the common mean, right? Because these xi are iid. I mean, it's then the same expectation for all. Now make this a random variable, guys, meaning I'm after this expected y given n, capital N, not for a specific little n, but I'm considering all possible n's, right? It becomes an RV now. Now I can see actually bring this formula, right? Expression now is write it with actually the random variable. So I replace that specific n here with little n here with the random variable n, because n is also a variable now. Is this fine? I mean, it's really like we took again this given n equals n to nrv, meaning now I really also don't know which little n I picked or which capital N actually I picked. So the actually y given n becomes a random variable itself. Okay, now this is an RV. I'm making it an RV because I will also, now I'm able to, it's not because of that, but now I made it an RV, I can take its expectation, iterated expectation. That's the goal. I think you guys see where this is going. Right, this is, now we can take, because it's an RV, we can take its expected value, right? We can do this. What is this? You guys know this from the law we've learned in the first hour. It's just expected y. It becomes an unconditional expectation. Expected y is actually, what is it? We calculated it, right? It is actually n times expected x, right? Expected y is, I mean, can be written in this way, right? This is an RV. Am I here correct, guys, at this point? I'm taking exactly actually this one I already calculated in this way. Guys, what I did is really I didn't look at expected y, but I'm now inserting expected y given n right into my expectation. That's how I'm going. Actually, I'm not using expected y, right? I inserted the value I calculated for that conditional expectation inside, which was n times expected x. N and x are independent. So how can I write that last term? Rewrite the last term, knowing n and expected x. Even actually, I don't need that, right? Even I don't need independence. This is a number, right? It's an average, so it can go out of the expectation. It's like a constant in terms of this expectation. So this is really, so this is a number, a constant number, expected n times expected x actually. So I mean, we found that actually expected y is equal to the product of expected n times expected x using law of iterated expectations. Okay. Now we look at variance next. So we've done this. Now let's look at the variance question. Now variance, this was question. Now we are after variance. And you guess that we'll use the total variance loss. Okay? Remember, it requires expected value of the variances, conditional variances, plus variances of the conditional expectations, right? This is the law. So now let's write this as the total variance law. Use total variance law for your notes, okay? And again, do a first term and a second term calculation, one, and we'll do two later. So we are after the first term. First, let's look at variance of, again, y given n equals, first fix it, then make it a random variable. That's the idea, like we did before, guys. Like we did here. First, this is for a specific little n, what is variance y? Guys, so this is, remember, x1 plus x now becomes little n, right? Y is equal to this guy. Remember, xi are independent, identically distributed. So what is their variance? Some variance. It's really n times variance x, actually. Guys, this is really due to variance of a sum of independent n independent RVs, okay? Equals to sum of their variances. We've done these before, so this is it. Now, again, do the same thing. Make this a random variable. Meaning, don't consider a specific little n, but for the capital N now, it becomes, you know, itself this random variable, n times the variance x. So again, this is an RV, is a random variable. This is good. Now, I can take its expectation. That's the first term, because that's what I'm after. Now it's really what I want, expected variance of y given n, right? And what is the expectation there? Variance x there is just a number, right? Like a constant. So it's really expected n times variance x. So that is the first term. A lot of manipulations with conditional expectations, conditional variances. That's it. We are just doing some manipulations. So now let's go to the second term. Now we need expected or conditional expectation of y given n. Let's do this. Expected value given n. I think we found this on the previous page. Yes, here. Guys, look, the line before the last line. Right? Expected y given n, it was capital N times expected x, right? So, sorry, this was really n times expected x found on previous page. We've done it, right? Now I'm after, to calculate the second term, I'm after the variance of this. Guys, yes, exactly, variance of expected y given n. Guys, you can think of this is a number, right? So this is really a number. So this is really like z is like a times n. What is variance of z? We've done it. This is a constant or just a number. This is the RV. And this is an RV, a scaled RV. What is its variance? A squared. Remember, because a goes into that squaring, a squared variance n. So we'll use this, okay, here. So that will be really expected x squared times variance n. Guys, we just applied that thing in the box. Because expected x is really like a number, and the variance of that random variable is like it's a scaled random variable, right? Scaling of n by a or expected x. Okay, now from here we will find variance y as addition of the two, 1 plus 2, which will be expected n times variance x plus, I need to really close this door. All right, first term we calculated there. Second term we just calculated, so it's really the square of the expected x times the variance. And remember, it was really like first one was from the total variance law up there. This is the average of the individual variances, right? In a way. So this was average of, we call it within variability. Within variability, okay? Average of within variability, like variance of the total money spent in each store, in a way, right? Within, I mean, variability. Let's see, this was variability between, right? The second term was variability between, let's see, variability between. Does it help us? Average of within variability versus variability between. I'm trying to see whether we can really interpret it in this way. Variance of the store number is there normally, and expected x squared. It's not, I was trying to see an intuition in this way there, but the resulting calculations doesn't show me that. Anyways, I mean, the interpretation is there, but it's in the first term, it's there, right? We have separate variance for each, multiplied by expected value of n. Variance x is there. This, I mean, this makes sense, right? I have variance of each x on its own. The other one can be interpreted in this, in the same way, probably. Any questions? This, it was the last example I wanted us to study on these conditional expectations, iterated expectations, total variance law. Now we go to limit theorems. Like I said, we'll complete two limit theorems today. We law of large numbers and central limit theorem, very important actually topics. And then next week we start statistical estimation. So it's the completion of the basic probability material, basic in quotes. Not that basic, but still, let's go to, if we are fine, you have to study, of course, go home and study on your own. Now let's go and study limit theorems. Guys, like I said, two important ones we will be studying will be, one will be weak law of large numbers. This will be interested in, we are interested in averages there, relates to averages or sample means. In the second one, central limit theorem, we are, will be dealing with distributions. Central limit theorem, this relates to distributions. Okay, so first let's start with the first one. Okay, so this will be CLT, this will be WLLN. Okay, first one is intuitively actually easy to understand. Let's say you want to calculate height of, or expected height of people in a population. It can be students at Istanbul Technical University. And it's not possible, of course, to go to every students. I don't know, maybe we have 30,000 students. It may not be possible, or if it's the population, right? So if I'm wondering still, if I pick one of you at random, what is the expected height that I could expect? We typically sample a practical number of people, right? And ask their heights, record those numbers and get a sample mean or some average. And we are wondering, guys, with these limit theorems, if I was able to increase that number of people I sampled to the take it to the limits, will that sample mean converge to the true expected value? That's the question that first limit theorem is going to be answering for us. Okay, so we will be looking at that. So in the first law, we want to come up with an expected value. Okay. And we are sampling, let's say, randomly. We take a sample from the population. And our big assumption is always here, IID, guys. I mean, people are identically distributed. Our sample is, at least in the sample, identically distributed and independent. Okay. Dependent sample, we come up with a sample mean. Okay, let's say we have a sample mean m sub n. You see, n is the number of students or people I picked, and I measured their heights, and I'm really calculating here an average, and I'm really wondering if I take this to infinity, what is happening? So actually, I'm wondering this mn. Does it really go to expected x in the limit? And also, I mean, this is really saying, is my sample mean representative? Also, is this convergence in a special sense, in probability, in distribution, we have to also talk about that together. Is my sample mean representative in a way? That's the underlying question. This one is the first question. Also, I was saying, in what sense? Convergence is in what sense? Is it in probability or in distribution in a way? So we want to study these convergences. By the way, as we did until here, this sample mean MN will be also an RV, because that N also here, you see, or first of all, N, even if I fixed N, because the sample I'm taking is random, right, from the population. So MN becomes MN is an RV, is a random variable. The samples we collect are always random. I sample n people, I measure, right? I sample another n people, that's another collection, right? That's why. So to study these convergences, guys, we have to study a few tools. This lecture is a little bit becoming mathematical, but not above your level. It's exactly your level, so you should be able to follow. We'll first study guys, a few tools in order to study these convergences or limit theorems, let's say. I mean, these limit theorems require those convergences, or also these tools, actually. First one, okay, is the Markov inequality. So let's define these guys. Markov inequality. It's like this. These are actually very straightforward mathematical manipulations. Let's say we have an RV X, and let's say X is non-negative RV and it's discrete. Let's assume it's discrete RV. Okay. It's fine if it's not discrete. I'm writing it as a sum. X times px of x, guys. It was a positive RV, right, or non-negative RV, Now what we will be doing is we'll say, let's pick a number A, guys. So maybe, I mean, I said discrete, I'm drawing a continuous RV, but it's fine. So let's pick an A. I want to, instead of summing this for all X positive, or maybe actually it, I said it's already positive, so maybe X was here. Now I want to really sum it up after A. So let's not write equal here. So it's gonna be like this. Now I limit my integration or sum to all X is greater than equal A, okay? And do write the same thing. How are these two sums related, guys? I mean, this is also already, of course, positive, right? For a discrete RV, actually, then that is. What is the relation? It's not equal, of course. Which one is bigger? Mm-hmm. Exactly. So that is larger, exactly, bigger or equal. Now I can also, this is really well-known mathematical manipulation. Now I know that sum on the right-hand side, right, is larger than this sum where I replace my X with A, right? Because A is the lower bound for all those X's that are larger than A, right? So I'm really putting the lower bound here, right, which is A actually. So that is still larger than Q. Now A can go out, of course, this is an equal X A P X of X. Guys, what is this? That is probability that X greater equal A. So the goal here was, guys, to relate probabilities. So Markov inequality says, Markov inequality in sum, to sum up, it relates expectation to probabilities, actually. So we found expected value of X is greater than or equal to A times probability that X is greater or equal to A. So if, for instance, my expectation is small, guys, probability that X is very large would also be small, right? Because it's being larger than some A. If expected value is small, probability that I pick an X and it being large would also be small, for instance. So in a way, Markov inequality for us related smallness of expected values to relates to smallness of probabilities. So probabilities from here will go to another quality called, it's coming soon. Let me see, Chebyshev, but okay, let's derive it. First inequality, these are some mathematical tools. Now, guys, we'll make this a centered, I will rewrite it in a centered way. So rewrite its centered version. What does it mean? I just subtract away the mean, okay? So subtract the mean now from both sides. Now it's squared, right? It's squared version actually. Okay, probability that X minus mu squared greater than or equal. Okay, I can. Actually, it's A squared, it doesn't matter, right? It's A or whatever number is there, right? It could be just C or W. Multiplying dash, right? That probability should also go into the inequality inside the probability. That's why it doesn't matter here, right? Whether it's A squared or some other number. It should just be the same number. That's important. Now, because we are trying to relate this time variance X to this guy, right? Probability that X minus mu squared is greater or equal to A. So again, relates the variance to the probability that the RV is away, far away from its mean, of course, measured in terms of the squared distances here, right? And let's see if my variance is small, guys. Let's see. How is this probability? It is, because it's less than the variance, it has to be also small. So my probability of being away from the mean is also small, which makes sense, right? When variance is small, I'm closer to the mean. So these inequalities make sense, I'm trying to say, right? I would be really not far away from the mean. So I think this can be derived in another way too. I mean, a lot of mathematical derivations, but we could have obtained this, guys. This is the result here. This will lead to another inequality, Chebyshev inequality. But we could have, before we go to write that result, another derivation for this result. We came from Markov inequality, but we can also come to this. Let's say we have X and RV with finite mean and variance. Mu, let's say, finite mean mu and variance sigma square. Guys, now let's start from the definition of variance this time. You see, I mean, manipulations of these equations is important. Guys, look at, again, maybe just an exemplary PDF here, okay? Px of x, let's say. It's not mean. Now I want to look at these integrals, mu plus minus c. Okay, we want to look at the area, compare the area under this, like when mu the x I pick is greater than mu plus c or less than mu minus c. This area, compare it to the whole area, right? This is the whole area, of course, weighted by the x minus mu squared. Now I want you to look at mu minus c, mu plus c, this area, right? It's the shaded area up there, right? Px dx. Actually, not in between, sorry. Minus infinity to mu minus c. Minus infinity to mu minus c plus, of course, mu plus c to plus infinity. X minus mu square. The one I wrote was, of course, in the middle, right? P x of x dx. So the relation then between these two is the whole area weighted by the x minus mu square would be still larger than these two, right? I mean, the shaded area in red is definitely less than the whole area, because this is also positive, by the way, right? So there is a greater equal sign going from the integral and at the first line to the two integrals in the second line, right? Okay, so now we replace this distance, because this distance is c, okay? We replace now these with the constant value, okay? Because in this region, right, let me see, this distance is greater than or equal to c, right? When I pick an x here, mu minus c, or that distance will always be larger than c, because I'm on the right side of mu plus c. So now I'm even making the integral smaller right here. So this is really c squared goes out, minus infinity to mu minus c x of x dx, and the same here, right? Plus c squared mu plus c to infinity px of x dx. Are we okay? Okay. So Now these two together give me actually the probability that exactly that underneath area actually probability that x minus mu is less than or greater. So equal to c light by c square. So what we derived in the end is really the variance, guys. Right of this RV or any RV actually take its calculate its variance. It is greater than or equal to take it and calculate the area underneath a distance away, go a distance c away from the mean and calculate the areas outside that interval. Exactly the shaded area here, right? This and this. That is that shaded area, right? The addition of those two. It's equal to this one actually. So you see, we actually have derived an equivalent version of the thing up there actually. In absolute value, right? Bir tane. Okay, I forgot that. The two are equivalent. So now we can write the Chebyshev inequality. So for any RV, if we know it has a finite mean and variance, guys, let's write this. Chebyshev inequality, guys. We just require to know mu and sigma squared, okay, of the RV. Of the RV, this says probability that I'm actually more than c far away from the mean is less than or equal to variance this RV over c squared. Remember, c squared was next to the probability multiply. So again, we tied probabilities and variance in this case, or expectation. That's another expectation. So for instance, if c is large, my probability that I'm c farther away from the mean, that probability will be small, right? If c is large, because probability is smaller than or equal to 1 over c squared. Okay. Another version is, let's see, be a multiple of the standard deviation. So this also tells me, you see, being k sigma further away from the mean, that probability is less than or equal to 1 over k squared. It's just a rewrite we are doing. This is all expectations, probability manipulations, guys. Okay. So this Chebyshev bound is a conservative bound. For example, I have, let's say, a normal, standard normal. Okay. Let's look at this. Okay, for also a Laplace. All right. Guys, here, draw it a little bit nicer. And standard normal, let's say, but let's just put a mean here, and we try to go mu plus c. I'll make that c as k sigma actually, and mu minus c. Okay, and let's compare x is a normal or x is a Laplace. Remember, Laplace was a heavy-tailed distribution, right? More heavy-tailed. This was 1 over 2. It was actually while Gauss Gaussian is e to the minus x squared, Laplace is e to the minus absolute value of x, right? And let's say this is really Laplace 0, 1. So this is expected x, this is variance x, okay, or sigma squared. So you see both of these distributions have zero mean, right? Both have mu equals zero and sigma squared equals one. Okay. Chebyshev inequality just looks at those two actually. That's why it's a conservative bound. It says for any distribution with mean mu and variance sigma squared. For instance, I look at C is equal to 3 sigma case from the Chebyshev probability, or Chebyshev inequality being 3 sigma farther away from the mean. What is that probability? Guys, that is, right? That probability being 3 sigma further away the mean. Look at the Chebyshev inequality less or equal to sigma square over 3 sigma squared, right? Right. 3 sigma squared, which is really, okay, it should be really 3 sigma squared. So this is really 1 over 9, which is 0.1111. So it gives us this 11% actually probability that I am actually 3 sigma further away from the mean, but this is for any distribution with Chebyshev inequality using. Guys, okay, so this is really, maybe I should say this is 3 sigma. We are looking at 3 mu plus 3 sigma, mu minus 3 sigma, right? So we are really, aren't we just looking at these probabilities here, right? Let me also plot a Laplace. For instance, let's say this is a Laplace, this is a Gaussian. Guys, I mean, the areas are obviously different, right? This is very conservative. It sets a very high bound, very conservative high bound. How can we check this? Can we calculate this? So this is for the Laplace, right? This would be for the Laplace, but this would be, this blue one would be for the Gaussian, right? This is for the Gaussian. Can we calculate an exact value for the Gaussian, for that integral probability to be greater than or equal, you know, mu plus minus 3 sigma? Yes, right, from the tables. Exact, we can get an exact value. For Gaussian, guys, here I'm trying to calculate the bound we get or compare the bound we got from the Chebyshev inequality to the exact bound, for instance, we will get from the Gaussian or exact integral. That's the idea. For Gaussian, for instance, we can calculate an exact value for this one, probability, which is probability that x minus mu being greater than or equal to 3 sigma. This is 1 minus 3 sigma to 3 sigma, right? 2 over pi. Actually, probably I should stick with the this one here. It would be CDF, right? Mu minus 3 sigma plus 1 minus CDF mu plus 3 sigma, right? From what is that phi? The CDF of the Gaussian normal. Normal CDF, right? This is, right, phi, recall, is normal CDF. And when you write in those numbers, guys, that comes as 0.002. Oh, okay. That's a 0.2%. This is, I'm trying to say, a very tight bound now. Why is Chebyshev this conservative, so higher bound? Because it didn't consider the specific distribution. It has to be valid for all distributions, guys. That's the reason. This is a very tight bound. But Chebyshev is a very conservative bound. You see the difference? For instance, Laplace, we would have something in between, right? Because Chebyshev is also valid for the Laplace distribution with the same mean and variance, of course. Okay, so you see, we're looking at tail probability. These will be required for convergence, actually. Now we go to convergence. Guys, a little bit calculus, a little bit more, then we should be fine. Okay, maybe except even if you are lost, you can catch it from here, catch up. This is the Chebyshev. Now we look at convergence, some convergence type, convergence in probability, because we are actually trying to study limits of sequences. It will be okay. So we are really after this. So given a sequence, these will be random variable sequences. A sequence A1, A2, for instance, AN. We study whether, for instance, AN goes to A, or we say limits AN as N goes to infinity, right, is A. When A are numbers, probably you've already studied this before, right? Let's see. Then, for instance, this is A. I have a lot of A, and let's say here as increases. It's a sequence. I mean, AI is right. AI, AJ. Here, all of these are A values. A case. We typically remember to study this convergence. We typically look at a bound, right? An epsilon bound, A plus epsilon, A minus epsilon, around the limit value. Remember, we try to see as n increases whether we stay in this bound, right? As n goes to infinity. That was the, this is a constant, of course, right? Sorry for the thing. So we want to see typically for, this is your basic calculus for all positives. There exists some large n up there, right? And zero, such that for all n above, after actually in my sequence, after that n zero, I stay within that band. Remember, this is typical convergence. I mean, this is usual convergence, right? Mathematical definition of convergence. From your calculus 101 probably, right? Is that right? Now, guys, we will look at this time random variables. A's were numbers here, the A's. Now, this time we have random variables. So actually, so let me write this. Now, AN's are RV's, okay? That's the difference now. Now each of these guys will have, guys, this time some distribution, okay? This time they will have some. So let's say this was A. Again, we will look at some bounds, okay? Any thing here, any of these AN's will have some distribution, okay? Maybe my, okay, this is a distribution. As N goes up, This is really, this way is n is increasing, right? Sorry, not there, but I should write it here. N is increasing and in that direction. So it will be really like trying to track those tail probabilities. Okay, so maybe now those tails are getting smaller, guys. I mean, maybe it's not looking like that exactly, but here maybe let me try to make this smaller. These are getting, you see, this time it's really like those, as n increases, those tail probabilities are getting smaller and smaller. So most of the distribution stays in that band actually, a plus minus epsilon. So very similar idea for random variables. This is actually convergence in probability. So the idea is as n goes up, probability of falling, okay, outside a plus minus epsilon gets smaller. That's the thing we are looking. This is called convergence in probability. We'll write it mathematically, of course, but this is the picture you have in mind, okay? The old tail probability. So we'll write something in this way. X sub n minus a, its probability greater than b, you know, or x n staying in the a plus minus epsilon band will go to zero as n goes to infinity. This is what I'm trying to say. This is called convergence in probability. Guys, you know this one from before, from calculus 101, right? Now, probably this is the first time you are seeing the convergence in probability. You see, we rewrote in a way. This was just calculating or looking at the direct distance, right? Or an being in that a plus minus epsilon band. Now we are looking the probability of being in that same band. Okay? Being epsilon away from the a as goes to infinity, that probability should go to zero. That's the convergence in probability. So let me write the mathematical definition. In this picture, do you see distributions getting more concentrated in this a plus minus epsilon band in that picture? Does everybody visually at least keep this picture in mind? Okay. So now we write the mathematical definition of convergence in probability. Okay, probability. It says sequence of RVs xn converges in probability to a number a. In this case, for every non-negative epsilon, I wrote it, but let me rewrite it. Limit as n goes to infinity, this probability of being epsilon further away from a becomes zero. So tail probability, equivalently, tail probabilities go to zero, right? Go to zero as n goes to infinity, actually. That's the idea, guys. Where, okay, we will be using this now. You know the definition of convergence in probability because we'll state or use this in the definition of the weak law of large numbers. That's why we needed to define this, okay? So weak law of large numbers, okay, let's write it in this way. Let's define this weak law of large numbers, WLLN, say this one, X1, X2, these are IID RVs with finite mean mu and finite variance sigma square, Now let's write the sample mean, because we are looking at its convergence properties. It's an RVE, remember, x1 plus xn over n. This is, or let's, okay, let's look at its expected value, first of all. What is its expected value? It is expected x1 plus expected xn right over n. Or let's write it constant this way, in the original way, which is much better. This is, they are IID, so numerator is n times mu, n times mu over n. You see it's mu. But how big is the variance is important. How big is the variance, guys? So let's write the variance of mm. Variance mn. So this is the question, right? So what are these variances? Again, variance of plus xn over n. They are IID, identically distributed. They, each of them has sigma square variance. N goes out of the variance formula by 1 over n squared, right? Like that. Okay. Yes. So it is really 1 over n squared times n sigma squared, right? The numerator has n times sigma squared. So I really have sigma squared over n. So guys, with Chebyshev inequality now comes into picture. The Chebyshev, what was it? And then we'll say, you see, Chebyshev looks at the tail probability. So it is something we use to study convergence improbability, right? We look at the tail probability in this case. So we'll say here, okay, we calculated the variance and the expectation of this sample mean RV. Now let's use Chebyshev inequality. It's difficult to write inequality, guys, which is telling me the probability that I am epsilon away, or more than epsilon away from the mean. This is what I'm after. This is the probability I'm after. Chebyshev inequality tells me this is less than or equal to variance mn over that epsilon is the constant we picked. It was c before, right? Now it's epsilon. What was variance n? We just calculated as sigma square over n and epsilon squared. What happens to this probability as n goes to infinity? It's obvious, of course. Zero, of course, right? That probability goes to zero. So it's like the probability that I am really epsilon away from the true mean, right? As n goes to infinity, becomes zero. This proves that the sample mean convergence in probability, actually, we've learned convergence in probability to the true mean, sample mean. So what we say here is really the weak law of large numbers. What it says is sample mean converges to the true mean in probability. This convergence is in probability. Okay, so this is the statement we proved now mathematically using, you see, that Chebyshev inequality converges in probability to the true mean mu. So sample mean was mn. Sorry, this was m. So then, okay. So as of course your number of sample size grows, so you take more and more samples, you can become more confident that that sampling or averaging you're doing is actually giving you a good idea of the true expectation. So guys, typical example of this or weak law of large numbers and central limit theorem, these are used in polling. Okay, for instance, polling is a problem where we are interested in, for instance, things like this. What fraction? This is a very important field, right, in sociology, or problem in sociology, statistics together. What fraction of the population prefers something is the question typically. That something is the question, of course. I mean, whatever you are interested in. For instance, I was giving the example of a Twitter poll in the recent years. I think Vedat Milor was giving this. Do you like soğanlı menemen or soğansız menemen? And that's a big question for Turkish people or Turkey. guys, I mean, these are the questions that polling people are after. Soğanlı menemen, that's the Turkish dish with eggs and onions. Onions with eggs with onions versus soğansız menemen. This is really eggs without onions. I think let's see if, of course, 80 million in this one. I recall this was something they did on Twitter. As I recall, I noted 437,000 people voted, and I think it was 50.6% soğanlı, and 49.5% was soğansız. I don't know if you voted there, but probably you see half-half almost, but I mean, if 80 million votes here, or I mean, this is very close, that fraction, but if it was, I mean, just for the example I gave, if 80 million prefers it that way, 30 million prefers it other way, you know, you look at the fraction here, right? Like, what is that fraction? P, you are after that fraction. Actually, here I wrote P is 3/8, but this is really the out of 80 million. Okay, this is not out of 80 million. I said it wrong. 80 million is the total population if I were able to ask everybody, right? And if I found out that 30 million liked it, that fraction is 3/8. So now we will be predicting this fraction. We can't ask everybody again. We are predicting that fraction. So that P is fraction of population again that prefers something, okay? That prefers something. We are polling just a number of people. So let's say eight person randomly polled, and we're trying to predict this P. Our goal is predict P, okay? Eight person randomly polled, nice. Let's model the answers to this question as a Bernoulli random variable. Maybe says one soğanlı. Okay, yes to this soğanlı, and the others say no, soğansız. Okay, let's say this is actually equivalent to this problem, right? Bernoulli RV with probability P, with, let's say, with probability P. Okay, maybe I should have said P1 minus P, right here. 1 minus P, and yes. That would be the exact, but we are after a prediction, MN, which is really our P hat, okay? We poll N people, okay, guys? And we are really after question that this MN goes to, whether it goes to this P or not. And our goal is, okay, actually I said this is the prediction fraction. Let me write it in that way. This is for us guys, prediction of fraction, and our goal will be, for instance, we want to be also confident, 95% confident. With 95% confidence, can we really say this with 1% error, or approach that P with 1% error? So this is really like, you will be able to tell me P, for instance, tell me that fraction, guys, within 1% error. So, e.g., if, for instance, P is 0.45, I want you to answer me within this interval. Okay? Your answer, does it fall in there? That's the idea. Answer within this range. So this is what we are after. So let's look at the probability. Probability is here. So probability that a man approaches P with this desired accuracy. Okay, this is the accuracy, guys. Desired accuracy. And I want this probability, like probability of being no further than, right? 1% from the true fraction. I want this to be less than or equal to 5%. That's the confidence, 1 minus confidence. This is we are after. This is all about polling. Actually, we started statistics at this point, but we are using probability theory as a tool at this point. You realize that, right? Probability theory tools are helping us to do statistics. Okay? This is desired confidence. Desired confidence. Why do we need a confidence? Because every time we sample, we get something else, right? Sometimes we may get lucky or we may get unlucky. It may be a very, very different sample. You know, it may not be a representative sample. That's why we put this confidence actually value there. So, guys, we will ask a few questions here. We will ask these questions now. For instance, I want to ask you, how large should my sample be, sample size be? So how large n should be to satisfy these specs, specifications? That's a question, for instance, polling people typically ask themselves. So here in this case, you see, we are really fixing these specs. These are the specs. These are specs or specifications, right? Now, to meet this, my question is, how large n? How large n, or which is the sample size you should use? Okay. Use to satisfy, the given specs or specs given by the pollsters or polling managers or whoever is in charge. Okay, there is typically a polling manager, maybe a statistician, or actually it could be somebody like you in the future. Okay, you may be working for with these problems too, why not? So what were the specs? Accuracy and confidence. Guys, here's a sample size, and in sampling, there is an important thing. We should really sample uniformly. For instance, if it's a voting preference, typically these are done, right? When election times are coming, there are election polls. If you just sample from your parents, your friends that will be quite a biased polling estimate prediction, right? Voting prediction. You have to really go to different segments of the society, different socioeconomic levels, perspectives, then it's a uniform sampling. Otherwise, it's a very biased sampling. The results you get will be useless. Note the importance of sampling uniformly is really randomly, right? In a way, I should maybe note this so you don't forget. Don't sample, for instance, only from the relatives of a candidate, for instance, relatives of a candidate in voting polls. Okay, I mean, this probably makes the point, right? So now again, our Chebyshev was, okay, Chebyshev inequality, go back to that. Chebyshev was this, probability that I am, what were the specs? 1% away, at most 1% away from the mean, that probability was less than or equal to variance, right, of a man over actually that number squared here, right? That's a, like a C number, and it's coming here as the squared. So what was the MN variance? We found it, I think. Guys, variance of MN was here, right? This is variance MN sigma square over M. So I'll just write it here. Sigma square or X probably over N 001 squared. We want this to be less than or equal to 5%, right? Those are the specs. This is the spec, this is the spec. Now, one more thing, however, we need to also get an estimate for this guy, but this is the variance of a Bernoulli random variable, we know it. But we should, however, of course, I'm saying we know the form, sigma x square variance of a Bernoulli, we know the form, but we don't know its exact number, right? Variance of a Bernoulli, RV, remember that's equal to p times 1 minus p. You can easily calculate this. It's one of the easiest PMFs. Right, Bernoulli, I mean, just go there, zero with, you know, it's one, P with probability P one, right? And with probability one minus P zero, for instance, you can do the math here and find the variance P one minus P. Guys, what we will do, this is typically something that you should try to get an estimate for. We will get a bound for it. So the form of this sigma x square, you can plot this as p changes from 0 to 1. It is maximized at 1 over 2, and it takes, this variance takes a maximum value of 1 over 4. This is sigma x square of p. That's the plot I'm showing you, okay? So we'll use the worst case variance, sigma x squared, which is the max value, which is equal to 1 over 4. You see, I'm trying to get an estimate for n, right? So I'm trying to really there leave n and fill in all other variables. That's what we are trying to do. So now, where were we? We were at the end here. Just bring it here now. It was sigma x, let me rewrite it, sigma x squared n over 001 squared. Now we'll replace this with 1 over 4, guys. This will be, that's the worst case. So less than or equal, this was less than or equal to, sorry, already 5%. Now, 1 over 4 n 10 to the minus 4 less than or equal 5 10 to the minus 2 from here we found n guys to be greater than or equal I mean you can do the math but okay let me write it 4 times 10 to the minus 4 5 times 10 to the minus this is about 50k 50,000 people but we had it's a lot of people by the way guys we found and if number of people you poll with is 50,000 this was remember through Chebyshev this is a conservative estimate it is estimates through Chebyshev with 1% error by the way we satisfy that our sample mean okay over those 50,000 people will be close to the true fraction okay with 1% error and we are confident that this happens with actually 5% confidence actually 95% confidence okay so this is what you find but normally guys typically you guys probably hear this during election times you they don't ask these polling firms they don't ask 50,000 people recently I was listening on the radio they asked I think 1800 people 1800 so typically it's 1000 to 2000 people because you have to personally ask them it's not a Twitter poll in Twitter you can ask millions but those responses are not really verifiable right therefore for more reliable polling still is happening personally they phone them talk to them or outside ask them you know therefore this is really 50k is not a very is not a very practical number so what would you do maybe then you decrease or change your specs okay so you can actually make it so solution so what to do let's say what to do you can make it less conservative meaning for instance you can allow 3% error for instance allow not 1% but 3% error you redo your calculation probability that mn minus p this time greater than or equal 0.3 you are after this you do the same math this 0.3 squared will be coming on the other side that's instead of 1% it will save you guys instead of 1% will save you a factor of 10 approximately so 5000 you need 5000 people in this case not bad I mean still not like in this 1 to 2000 band but which may still be fine actually okay I think we can give a break and then study central limit theorem okay let's give a break all right we will study central limit theorem next week guys see you then okay